This is not designed to be a criticism or a personal attack session. Unless you want to personally attack me, unless you want to attack me, then that's okay. I will cut off any attempts at personal criticism, personal attacks. We're trying to solve a problem here, and that's what we're here for. I do appreciate all the CRTPO and municipal officials that showed up. My fellow legislators that are here, they're welcome to join us at the table, but they don't have to. As well as a lot of the elected officials we see in this room, and of course, most importantly, the residents of this community. So with that, what we're going to do is pretty simple. We're going to start. I did a coin toss last night. DOT will go first based on the coin toss. I actually did a coin toss. Just in case y'all want to know, everybody is sitting alphabetically by government entity, so no one can criticize where they sat. I've tried to be very methodical about how we accomplish this goal. So DOT will do a presentation followed by the legislative chamber. There will be no questions during the presentation. Anybody who has a question from the participant list, the invitation list, please write your questions down. We will do a short bathroom break after the two presentations. We will come back and we'll do Q&As until we're blue in the face or blue. So with that being said, yes, sir.
Since you've been a part architect of this session, could you or someone explain what the issues are?
I'll give you the 30,000 foot level. If I go any further below that, my guess is we'll start getting discrepancies of what the issues are. The predominant purpose of this is to let DOT and the Lake Norman Chamber folks who will present point and counterpoint of this issue to explain what the concerns are. Ultimately, this is predominantly about the I-77 managed lane project, but we have to look at the managed lane project as a regional aspect. And so I think we're going to get a quick background of how we got here, and then what are the ramifications of any change, and what are the possible changes. One thing I think we've got to be mindful of is any decision like anything else has a ripple effect. We've got to understand what the ripple effects are before making a decision and make sure that we're comfortable or satisfied with what those ripple effects are. So if I could, real quickly, I would like to introduce or have them introduce themselves more apt. The people that were on the invitation list that are here around this table, I'll start with Bruce from the town of Cornelius.
I'm here on behalf of Washington. We had a trip planned for months, and so I'm a CRTPO alternate for town of Cornelius.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Chuck Travis, the mayor of Cornelius.
I'm John Woods, the mayor of Davis.
Good morning. I'm Beth Passion, town of Davis.
Brian Finesse from Davidson.
John Anarello, mayor of Connersville.
Dan Phillips, town of Connersville.
John Fraley, North Carolina, representative of District 95, Southern Iredell County.
John Bradford, House of Representatives, District 98, Northern Mecklenburg County.
Jeff Hart, North Carolina Senate, and welcome Representative Bradford, and I would like to welcome you to our district.
David Curtis, State Senate 44, Iredell County.
Good morning, Trevor Fuller, Chairman of the Mecklenburg County Commission.
Pat Cotham, County Commissioner at Large.
Good morning, Miles Atkins, Mayor of the Town of Mooresville.
Bobby Compton, Commissioner, Town of Mooresville.
Katie Dingler, Commissioner, Town of Mooresville.
Michael Johnson, Mayor Pro Tem of Statesville and Clark Rosewood member.
Good morning, Mike Russell, Chairman of the Lake Norman Chamber of Commerce and Chief Operating Officer of Matt.
John Hepler, local business owner of Payroll Plus and the 2009 Chairman of the Chamber.
Bill Russell, President of Lake Norman Chamber of Commerce.
Jim Puckett, Mecklenburg County Commissioner, and since my friend Ben Malik isn't here, I get to say I represent the most powerful district in Mecklenburg County, something she normally takes the credit for.
I'm Nick Tennyson, Secretary of Transportation for North Carolina.
Ned Curran, Chairman of the Board of Transportation for North Carolina.
Roger Rochelle, Technical Services Administrator, North Carolina DOT. Bobby Lewis, NCDOT, Chief of Staff.
Shelley Blake, General Counsel, NCDOT.
Jim Ray, Consultant to DOT.
Walt Gray, Chief Deputy Secretary, NCDOT.
Good morning. Mike Oliver, Chief Engineer at NCDOT.
Hi, I'm Mike Charbonneau, Communications for NCDOT.
Back to me. I guess I introduce myself. I'm Charlie Jeter. I am home of the new NASCAR 2015 champions in District 92, Joe Gibbs Racing. So Mooresville may be Race City USA, but Huntersville is Championship City USA. So I'm sorry, Miles, did that hurt? I think y'all finished in the top 10? Not really. We're having technical difficulties. I am our Cornelius Racing Group.
We came down today hoping to talk about viable, realistic alternatives to the solution that's already been identified, and that's what we hope we'll all be focused on. We understand that there are concerns in the region, in this particular part of the region, about decisions that have been made, and I want to get beyond the point of trying to identify every potential possibility under the sun and move toward realistic, viable alternatives. So am I doing a next slide thing? Okay, so next. So we understand what the problem is. We are not confused about what the focus needs to be, and that is congestion in the region. The problem of every economically successful city on the planet. Congestion because people are moving from point to point and they all want to go at the same time. Next. We also want to make sure that we're clear on what this is as a question. This is a regional question for CRTPO. This is a regional strategy that was identified by CRTPO after years of study. The managed lanes concept that's being implemented is not a one-off or a standalone project idea. It is part of a network, and that's the way these things function best. I was just in Denver, had a chance to be on their managed lane that they've recently opened, and the new segment has opened just in July, and the segment that had been operating for the last 2 years, and underperforming its projections, just over the last few months, now that it's connected to a second segment, is now overperforming its projections. And all that is to say, a connected network was the idea behind the CRTPO decision, and this is the first phase of that. So as you can see on this, or maybe you can see, on this illustration from April of 2015, at 5 p.m., the red is areas where the speed limit, average speed, was below 45, the green's above 45. Now, in other words, a lot of that segment is interstate, and 45 isn't a desirable speed for anybody on the interstate, but even at that low level, you can see substantial percentage of the whole area in red. Next slide. Now, this regional issue for CRTPO, for at least a few of the gentlemen seated along here and for Representative Jeter, is beyond a regional issue. It's a statewide issue. This is not the only area across the state with congestion. And when these gentlemen go to try to solve this issue or try to make take steps to mitigate the problem, they're going to be working in conjunction with colleagues from across the state. So while this is a local question, it also is one that needs to be addressed from a statewide and regional perspective. Just to illustrate the timeline on which we've been moving, the fast lane study commenced in 2007. May of 2010,
hot lanes, high occupancy toll lanes, where express lanes were endorsed as a strategy. March of 11, the 10-year transportation improvement program was adopted with this project included. NCDOT started work in 2011 with the MPO staff on the project. July 12, legislation was passed to allow P3s, public-private partnerships. Then in May of 2013 is when the then Metropolitan Planning Organization, MUMPO, approved the project amendments, including P3. June of 2013, STI was signed into law. You heard mention of Strategic Transportation Initiative in other contexts, I hope. This law was intended to address the challenge that for the last 25 years anyway, transportation funding in North Carolina had not been based on congestion. It had been based on geography. So the change to the STI brought about a change to the way we're going to allocate funding in the future. July of 2013, MPO planning area boundary was expanded to take in Iredell County. Then we've got March of 14 was when we had our proposal deadline. April of 14, Centra was announced as the term of art as apparent best value proposer. That is a term applied to the bid that will be evaluated to make sure it complies with all the technical aspects of the contract. June of 2014, comprehensive agreement, which is basically the agreement to do the deal, the agreement between the state of North Carolina and the proposer to move ahead with the contract to try to actually deliver the project. May of 2015, we reached financial close. That was a date that was later than what we anticipated and required extensions to get to that point that were granted because there was no fault of the developer for the delay in getting to financial close. This is a process that included getting financing from a group or in a form that's referred to as TIFIA, which stands for Transportation Infrastructure Finance and Innovation Act. Transportation Infrastructure Finance Finance Innovation Act. So a kind of financing that's used commonly on major projects, a lot of them transit projects, light rail kind of projects. But among the challenges of dealing with a TIFIA loan is every one of their projects is a one-off. You go in, you talk to them, you think you've got a deal, and then you find out that you're back at the beginning. So let me just say, at every opportunity, Centra did everything they needed to do to get us to that financial close. North Carolina did everything we needed to do to get the financial close. It is not possible to move through that process on a predictable basis. So financial close was reached, and the project is now projected to open to traffic in January of 2019 is the contract date after which Centra will have to pay liquidated damages. Their practice and experience in the past has been to deliver projects several months before the actual due date. Next. The question of why express lanes. The fast lane study, which included Charlotte DOT, South Carolina DOT, North Carolina DOT, found that managed lanes provided the best immediate and long-term solution. Started with this road network of the roads that were being analyzed for the possibility of doing some sort of managed lane, ultimately narrowed it down to 77, that whole corridor for 77, plus 485 and the Independence and 74 to hook up to Monroe Bypass. One of the main things to focus on about this is the question of what is a long-term solution. And by that I mean, what is something where you're going to provide an alternative, a choice, a possibility of a reliable travel time over longer time horizon than just what had been encountered when the fast lane study was commenced. That study grew out of the experience of having widened I-77 south of Charlotte and then having it go, having that go from a traffic jam to widening to just a one lane wider traffic jam in very few years. And so the people that were involved in transportation planning wanted to make sure that whatever we executed had a longer potential time horizon than building just another lane to fill up and have a wider traffic jam. Next. The fast lane objectives. Fast lane objectives including accommodating long-term future demand, increase the people moving capacity, not just the vehicle capacity, the people moving capacity of the Charlotte Regional Roadway System, and increase trip reliability. Those are all aspects of an express lane project that make it the logical choice. This particular project has as an additional advantage that it's going to be a corridor-long solution. And so it will minimize the number of times that this road section, this roadway, is under construction. I think that any other alternative where we build, as we traditionally do, in shorter segments, is just going to expose the region to even worse congestion as we move the bottleneck up and down the corridor. Next. The other advantage is to this managed lane proposal, additional capacity is leaving the general purpose lanes as they are, except under this contract, they will be refurbished, brought up to standards. They will be much, much better condition than they currently are. And that will go from shoulder to shoulder. In other words, it won't just be the managed lanes that are in good shape. I'm sorry. The second point is that the express lanes are the only portion of the road for which there will be a toll. There's a substantial amount of confusion from people who have not looked at this very closely that we are somehow tolling all of I-77. It is not the proposal to toll the whole road. This is to identify the lane, the additional capacity that's being built, and to charge a toll to help recover some of the cost of building that extra capacity. And finally, with a transponder, HOVs, and any transit vehicle anytime, we'll not pay a toll. HOV3 will not pay a toll using that lane. Next. So, what's the investment in the region? It's a total of $775 million that is coming in to the region because of this contract. $535 million is coming in as private debt and equity, $250 million in private equity. And I want to make sure that we're all clear that that private equity is at risk. That is to say, we don't do anything to guarantee Sentra or Mobility Partners return of their equity. That's at risk. No recourse, contribution to the project. The $285 million in TIFIA and private activity bonds, the debt, in other words, on the project, are non-recourse to the state. Non-recourse to the state. That is to say, the general revenues of the state, the credit of the state, is not at risk to repay those bonds. Toll revenue is the only source of required repayment for those bonds. $95 million was put in, or is currently the amount that we're talking about putting in for public finance or public contribution to the project. Public funds put in to match that $250 I referred to, the other equity. I say currently because we are doing analysis that we believe is going to lead to lowering that amount. I don't want to promise that right now, but I also don't want to say 95 and then have us change to a different number later, lower, and have everybody decide that I wasn't telling you everything I knew right here. $145 million is the amount that was set aside under the STI it's a nominal 145. That is half of the debt that is financed by tolls. That's how that was calculated. This project had a cap of up to $200 million that could have been the bonus amount if we had had that much debt on it. We didn't. All future projects will have a cap of $100 million. So this project is getting additional funding that wouldn't be available to a P3 that was established later. Next. There is a number that has been thrown around that has people using $20 as that's what it's going to be when it opens up. Among other things that are also said is that this project isn't necessary for south of exit 23, that the congestion is not bad enough at south of exit 23. I've heard that criticism. That may not be what you feel, but I've heard that criticism. If congestion's not that bad south of 23 or south of 21 or south of whatever, then you don't have to be in the lane. You don't have to pay the toll. And so having a $20 toll amount implies that everybody has to be in the lane the whole distance, and that's not the way it works. Now, we have got a larger board that we're trying to find an easel to post on so that people can see. So we'll have this, Representative Jeter, we're going to have a break here after the presentations, right? Is that where you went? Anyway, we'll move this out so people can see it. But this shows where the access and egress points are. When we had the original contract, we're doing a break between, or after presentations, right?
After both presentations.
So I was just trying to make the point we'll be able to move this easel out so people can see this display. So there was, in the original agreement, a guaranteed minimum number of access and egress points. During design, during their proposal, Mobility Partners has come up with additional places they want to have access and egress. In the past, I've had people confront me and say, you can't tell me where the ingress and egress points are going to be. And I still can't tell you exactly, because there's still engineering to be done. But these are the locations, the exits that will be served, and you'll see that we have gotten to a much broader number of exits than was in the original minimum guarantee. There's also this question about a 50-year non-compete. This is a 50-year contract. For investment risk P3s, 50 years, actually 75 and 80 years are used elsewhere, but 50 years is the common industry standard for investments of this magnitude. There has got to be a chance for the private sector to mitigate their risk to be able to earn a yield on their investment. And it takes a longer time than some other forms of finance. You will hear of projects that are called availability payment deals. That's another term from the industry. This is an investment risk deal. The state has no risk on this for the return from this project. An availability payment deal, if you do it that way, basically the state makes a fixed payment every year for a briefer period of time. So this is common. 50-year deal is a common term for an investment risk deal. What's not universal is the deal we made here where we can still make changes to the corridor. Anything we do off of the corridor to improve the streets that are subject to the STIP, that are various projects that are in the state plan for projects and for intersections off of the corridor, are not affected by this agreement about not affecting the base case projection. We made a deal with Mobility Partners that made certain assumptions about the amount of traffic on the corridor. So we're not allowed to build a new freeway without calculating the impact on this deal. And if, after we build it, there is demonstrated negative impact on the developer's performance of the project, then the state may be liable for a payment. That doesn't prohibit it, and candidly, if we are in a position where we have enough demand so that we feel like we need an additional lane beyond what's already there, we will be in a position where we'll be able to justify it from the standpoint of how much money needs to be paid. If we hear that people are going to have to pay, or the state's going to have to pay if the project defaults, all of the debt is non-recourse to the state. Finally, the comment that the project will cause or increase congestion. The only reason this project is even on the drawing board is because everybody knows there's going to be congestion in this corridor. There's not anything about this project or anything else that anybody can propose that eliminates congestion, that is, by the way, meets that viable and plausible alternative. There is going to be congestion in the Charlotte region, as there is in every major economically successful city around the world. The question is, how do we mitigate that? How do we provide an alternative for mobility through the corridor, mobility through the region, mobility around the state, and still deliver projects that people can use on a daily basis? Next. So the choice for the CRTPO folks and your successors, and or with your successors, is you implement the fast lanes vision for the region. Next. If yes, we continue with the approved plan and the other projects that are a part of that vision, and we are on course, we have an actual firm choice that will deliver a project within 3 years. Next. If no, then we start back at the beginning of trying to come up with that viable alternative. We devise a new regional solution. And again, for the folks that are on CRTPO, maybe not the folks sitting here, but their colleagues on CRTPO, it's a 28-member body, something like that. This was not a single shot. This is a regional solution. So some regional solution will have to be determined to replace the one that's currently there. There will be costs to cancel this contract. What that number is, we have put forward a number that was based on advice we got from consultants. We think it's realistic, but candidly, it will ultimately be, if it goes that way, it will be the result of negotiation and or litigation, and specifying numbers right now isn't particularly helpful to our side in that case. But I assure you, the number we put out is not one from which I'm backing away. It's just not a case of wanting to throw that out either, because, candidly, it's not necessarily the biggest number that could happen. So there will be costs to cancel the contract. The $145 million in bonus allocation that was earned by having this project, all those projects go off the board, and that $145 million goes back into the pot for allocation under STI. So CRTPO to remove I-77 and bonus projects, 77 and the bonus projects from the 10-year plan, would have to vote on that at a formal meeting of that body, and then create and gain Federal Highway Administration approval for projects to submit in the new 10-year plan, go through the STI scoring, and to begin the new projects. There is nothing about that process for which I can give you any sort of firm timeline. I can only tell you that what we currently have is a project that leads to a 3-year completion date. Alternatives, there are just too many unknowns in the alternative path. I think that's it. Our commitment is we want to be a partner in the process. Whatever ends up happening, we want to help the region meet its goals, the entire region. We want to effectively manage contractual obligations and keep projects on schedule. And we want to preserve an open and transparent process and follow state and federal law. That's the way it looks to NCDOT, and I'm confident that we'll end up with a chance to talk a little more about this after the other presentation. Thank you.
We appreciate Secretary Tennyson's presentation. We will leave it now to the Lake Norman Chamber Group, who is going to present, I guess, the community's concerns. We will then take a break, a 15-minute break, and come back in as soon as the Russell twins, Commissioner Puckett and Mr. Hetwer, finish up.
Good morning again. I'm Mike Russell. I'm the 2015 chairman of the Lake Norman Chamber of Commerce, and Bill and I are not related. So I just want to put that out there. Thank you, Representative Jeter, for putting together today's summit and all your hard work that went behind it. Secretary Tennyson and your staff, thank you for your time coming here today for this, and all the elected officials. I think it speaks volumes to the importance of this issue that 3 days before Thanksgiving, we've got a packed house here with citizens and the media. So how did the Lake Norman Chamber get here? In 2013, the Chamber Board adopted some guiding principles around transportation funding. Basically stated, the Chamber supports transportation projects, roads, rail, mass transit, that provide movement around the region for business and citizens, as long as those projects do not have an adverse financial effect on those businesses and citizens. Fast forward to May of this year. After months of input from our members, the board of directors went ahead and passed a resolution respectfully requesting that the NCDOT cancel the contract with I-77 Mobility Partners. We also, in that same resolution, supported the efforts of our local elected officials and community leaders in their attempts to get the contract canceled. As the COO of a $40 million international company, I know the impact that this project is going to have on my employees, my customers, and my business. I look forward to discussing those with you as our presentation goes on. I'd like to now introduce John and Jim, and they will...
Thank you. It's a pleasure to be talking to all of you today, and this is actually a very serious moment, a very serious time for our community. Thank you, Secretary. My name is John Hetwer, and I'm a local business owner. I moved here in 1996, not as long as some of you, but quite some time. And I've seen and experienced firsthand the relative growth. I own a payroll processing company. We process payrolls for about 800 companies throughout the entire area, many of them in Mecklenburg County and South Iredell. And so I talk to my customers on a regular basis of what happens, how they're feeling, where they're at. And it is no longer a decision if they're for this or against this. It's very clear. And so I want to let Jim introduce himself, but the important thing is now as was the chairman of the 2009 chamber, seeing the facts, being an engineer and talking to a lot of people, we, the chamber, have some very strong feelings about where we're heading. And especially to you on the CRTPO, as you listen to us talk, we ask you to be empathetic, to understand how would you feel if this is your community. Jim.
Thank you. I am Jim Puckett. Just to give you a sense of history. One, my family moved here in 1755, so been here for a while, and they're all still here. You weren't the first or the second. You were the 900 and some odd thousand. In 1997, I served on the Mecklenburg County, Charlotte-Mecklenburg Board of Education. Did an awful lot with land use, put a lot of schools in the wrong places. We were also responsible for some poor decisions that have led to some of the problems we have today. In 2000, I went to Mecklenburg Board of County Commissioners. I served there for 6 years, took 8 years off, and the citizens let me have a chance to come back again. So I have a long-term view of this also. I have an awful lot of knowledge about mistakes that have been made over the last 20 years, and we'll speak to some of that. But my job is to represent the people that live in this part of Mecklenburg County. I am thrilled that I'm joined by our chairman, Trevor Fuller, and Commissioner Pat Cotham, who have also, the Mecklenburg County Commission, representing a million people, have asked that this be canceled for the reasons that you will see going forward. So with that, I'm going to let John give you our concerns.
Any chance we can get another mic? Is that possible? I don't know if there's anybody out there that can talk to the town. Go ahead, Mac. This is kind of, I always say the slide is kind of like the Mr. Obvious slide. All right, next one. I want to explain this for a lot of you, and some of you, hopefully all of you on CRTPO know, but this is the project that we're talking about, okay? It starts down here at Independence and goes all the way up to exit 36, okay? We know, and obviously we have limited resourceful dollars, and we have to plan ahead. Any of us in business know we have to plan ahead, but we also have to recognize where we have our a serious need. And our serious need, this project is 27.5 miles, $655 million of total cost, right? We don't dispute that. And there's $244 million already being put into this project from our local, or I should say from the NCDOT and other funding sources. That is our money, our tax dollars that are getting put on. The real congestion obviously exists between mile marker 21 and mile marker 36. And the secretary alluded to that. That is where our congestion happens. And what we have often said is said, just give us what we have at 21 and move it north. And that will buy us a lot of time. Obviously, there's substantial costs that's added to project because of infrastructure. Just the tolling infrastructure takes a lot of that $655 million. Next slide. I want to make something very clear, and we've said it before. The Chamber of Commerce is not against P3s. The Chamber of Commerce is not against tolls, right? There are some people out here that says no tolls, no tolls. But if you walk away today saying Lake Norman just doesn't want to pay tolls, you're missing the point. You're really missing where we're struggling with. I, and many of us, actually believe that managed lanes has a place. Managed lanes is a solution, but it has to be properly applied. Slide. Okay, the chamber and the business community is against this plan because this is a bad plan for our community. Let's talk about it. It puts our entire community at risk. We can talk about theory. As an engineer, I understand the theory of transportation as Mr. Secretary Tennyson just laid out. But at the end of the day, that's theory, and it works well in theory when properly applied. It's putting our business and residents at the Lake Norman area, putting us at risk, and people are already leaving. You've heard the press releases, right? Kozlowski's team just moved away. Employers are going out of business. Trucking people, trucking companies that need trucking, avoiding the Lake Norman area. Heck, when I was on Flashpoint last Sunday, Even of the Charlotte Chamber of Commerce president, Bob Morgan, said to me, well, I don't go up to Lake Norman for shopping because the traffic's too bad. So we need real solutions now. We already, there's nobody to argue, how many people from Lake Norman already felt a significant diminished quality of life, right? All right, your audience participation is done for today, but let's make it clear. We are experiencing a quality of life degradation today. It's not in the future. It's not 20 years from now. Today, our quality of life has gone down in a community that people who moved here for quality of life. It doesn't help that it's being pressed upon us by others. Everybody who is against it, many are who are against it, don't live here. Don't live here. And that's very frustrating to us. Very few citizens within the Lake Norman community support this plan. Very few. It's a bad deal for the state. Going back. Oh, trucks can't use the managed lanes, so they are forced to use the general purpose lanes. Okay? So many of you are very familiar with EPA attainment. And this is saying, hey, we got to use, we're worried about EPA attainment. That is, if we don't keep the air quality standards, we lose our federal highway and monies. We don't understand how trucks sitting idle can help EPA attainment. Charlotte Intermodal Growth, we are the first to admit, Charlotte Intermodal was built, hopefully, to be successful. Okay? Internet commerce is driving truck traffic up. We know that I-77 is going to be increased truck traffic, but yet they're going to be relegated to the general purpose lanes, further exacerbating that problem. Okay. Obviously, we talk about the potential liability. Senators and representatives, I would like to ask of you, I've heard so much on both sides what the contract actually says, and I'd appreciate if you could go back to state auditors and let's get a clear ruling of, are we on the hook or are we all not on the hook? I've heard from attorneys we're on the hook, and I've heard from attorneys we're not on the hook. And it seems like that's something we should be able to get very clear, and somebody should be able to tell that community that. So there's three reasons why we fundamentally don't want this plan. Moral reasons, design flaws, economic development, financial. Moral. In 1990, a study was completed by NCDOT that indicated that I-77 didn't need to be four lanes from Statesville to the South Carolina line, four lanes in each direction.
And that's by 2010, by the way.
By 2010. Next slide. Look at that population growth. In 1990, Cornelius, Huntersville, Davidson, Mooresville, 24,554 residents based on the U.S. Census. Today, those same four towns, 131,084 residents, 533%. Here's the real question. Here's the question why Lake Norman is frustrated. How many north-south highway lanes have been built since 1990?
And let me jump in. It's not just Interstate 77. 115 is exactly the way it looked when my mother and father were there in the 50s. Okay? 21 is essentially exactly the same as it's been since it opened. There's been some tweaks. In the last 20 years, we've grown fivefold, and we have not even widened the shoulders from 115 to 21, let alone do anything to I-77.
We can talk about theory and how managed lanes manages congestion and everything else, but at the end of the day, the people who are out here there, we're fighting for our community. We're fighting for a solution that works for us. 25 years of paying tax, motor vehicle fees, 25 years of paying gas taxes from North Carolina, 25 years of paying federal gas taxes. We still do not have one north-south lane in 25 years. And so now we get a plan, and they say we have to pay for it. But that's okay. Because the reality is, back in 2010, right? Mayor Travis and I had this discussion. Back in 2010, John, we were given two solutions. Do nothing for 20 years, which I guess would be 45 years because we've waited 25, right? Do nothing for 20 years or accept tolling.
Let me, and this is where I don't wonder why I'm here. I'm like the color commentator. That hasn't been over 250 years of perspective. Here's the real problem with this. This is the reason that this room is full. This is the reason that these gentlemen who, Senator Tarp, who was Mayor Tarp at the time when this was approved, John Bradford, who was Commissioner Bradford, Representative Jeter, who was Commissioner Jeter at the time. These were the people who were told in 2010, you have two choices, do nothing or tolls. And it seemed to them that the choice was very obvious then. And I showed back up again a few years ago and said, you made the wrong choice. Here is what this is analogous to. If someone came to you and said, you have two choices, I'm going to cut off your head, or I'm going to cut off your arms. Which is the best choice? Cut off my arms. I don't like it, but clearly that's the best choice. Oh,
but I'm going to allow you to bleed out when I cut off your arms. Okay, maybe now I want you to cut off my head. What appeared to be a very obvious choice at the time was the worst choice. When Secretary Tennyson talks about a 3-year plan, we're saying, no, this is a 50-year bad plan made on a bad decision, made under wrong assumptions. This is the equivalent of what my father used.
I appreciate everyone's passion. We will treat everyone the same. There is no applause, no criticism, no nothing. The ground rules are clear. Let's let everybody say their piece. And let's do this professionally, please.
Okay, in fairness, I'm going to say Secretary Tennyson's name, and y'all can applaud. Yeah. Okay. Here's so this is why people change their mind, because those assumptions were wrong. And we're going to talk about where we are today. Let me have the next slide. I think it's there. This is our current reality. When we were told there was no money, there's now a $440 million surplus. When we were told there was no money, the governor said we have a $2 billion worth of bonding capacity for roads in this state. When we were told there was no money, I-85, just last week, has announced it's going to be widening gas to gallon. Asheville, $800 million. Asheboro, $240 million to widen the road around the zoo. It appears to us there is money. There might not have been in 2010, but there clearly is in 2015. And that's why we have to talk about the change. That's why these gentlemen who said this was the best idea at the time now say this is a different time. Again, as my father said, we don't know where we're going, but we're making great time. That's what this is equivalent of. We're going to get to a bad plan in 3 years and live with it for 50. And we're saying, every once in a while, you make a mistake, and you have to flip it around and then make the right adjustment. So let's go ahead and talk more about that.
This is one, every one of them drives a different, motivates different people different ways. This one is the one that got me involved. This one was the one that upset me personally the most, right? We've contracted with a Spanish company, as they said, because only in Spain or only in Europe can you get 50-year money. We are a 30-year banking system here in the United States. That's why it's got to be a European company. Okay? We would love to have an American company be doing this at this time. Okay? Number two, once again, and this is what drives, I've got a 3-year-old and a 9-year-old. This makes our children pay for our problems today, and or grandchildren in many your cases will be paying for these problems today. And as a businessman, the first dollar of principal gets paid off in 2033. And I'm happy to have you guys check that. The first dollar of principal. We negative AM for a while, right? We backstop. When we showed you the numbers that we talked earlier in the previous presentation, what they left off is there is a backstop of $12.5 million a year for the next 6 years. That's $75 million more dollars that we're already going to invest in it, and it wasn't on the previous slides of the secretary. It's very clear. This is another problem that bothers us. We've had citizens speak up against that. And in two cases already, this company who we're getting ready to get in bed with for the next 50 years threatened lawsuits against our citizens for executing on their First Amendment right to say, I don't like this plan and here's why. Now, luckily, we've got that pulled off, but that's the principle of it. That, to me, it's not a company I want to be in bed with the next 50 years. Design flaws. Next slide, please. This is probably, I want to go to the map here. This is probably one of the biggest problems we have as a community. As a community, this is why this is a problem. Okay? Now, I know you saw this map. We'll address this map in just a second. But this is the map that's on the I-77 mobility page today. I saw this map last night for the first time at 9 o'clock at night. I live personally right around exit 25. I have to drive to exit 30, the Community School of Davidson, to drop off my son. My business is at exit 28. These points here indicate gates to get into the toll lane and out of the toll lane. So therefore, from exit 23 to exit 31, there is one single gate. So if I had all the money in the world, which I don't, I couldn't use that tolling. The other problem that we have with this is, okay, let's go back to this. We're going to have all these egresses. Now what we're going to have instead is we're going to have an accident every single morning of everybody weaving back and forth. So the plan does not work for our community. It does not work for our community. Many of you might have seen, if you go to the Charlotte Chamber's website, you'll see a beautiful slide about the LBJ freeway, a video. Did you guys go see the LBJ? Okay. The mayors went to see the LBJ. I lived at the corner of Welch and LBJ, about a mile from it in the year of 1985. I lived there. It was crowded then. But here's the point. LBJ Freeway and this are not even comparable. Here's why. If this is the LBJ Freeway to this way, and actually it's a northeast east-west road, but this direction would be North Dallas, okay? Parallel road. There are 16, 20, 30 parallel roads all the way into Dallas, Texas going this way. On this side of the LBJ Freeway, Farmers Branch, Texas. Parallel road. The citizens, even when it was congestion, had lots of options. We have two. We have 77, and we have 115. And John, I think it's fair to say we're not going to widen 115 through Davidson.
Nor Cornelius.
Okay, so 115 is not getting widened. Right now, it's I-77 as our only choice. And so we can talk about managed lanes, we can talk about theory, but for us, it's about quality of life, and it's about our community. But all this should make you nervous, and what we're worried about will never scare you as much as the next slide. Next one. That's not it. This one. This is a slide that comes from the International Bridge, Turnpike, and Toll Association. This is their global summit in Prague, Czechoslovakia. A simple but challenging axiom. This is their industry. This is the toll and turnpike industry. Their local conference or their conference. The revenue potential and overall financial success of Priceless Express Lanes depends on the operational failure of the general purpose lanes. If we were going to have, this was ran by the state of North Carolina, I probably wouldn't be here because I knew political pressure, we'd get it changed. But now we've turned it over to a third party with bondholders with profit incentives. Are they going to run that road for throughput, or are they going to run that road for profitability? You know the answer. Maximum revenue from the express lanes often comes out at a price at which yield traffic in lanes well below free throw capacity. So you're saying this is going to relieve congestion. Perhaps, but one could argue if you take two cars off the road, it relieves congestion. It will not relieve congestion to the level of degree of our potential for this very limited spot, particularly the causeway.
One second. Let me give this perspective also. The tolls have been said that they will take a maximum of 20% capacity. We're going to double the amount of lanes, and we're going to take 20% of the congestion off the general purpose and put it into the other lanes. If you live up here, or if you come visit up here, I'd encourage you to do it. And leave your money. These exits are about 2 miles apart. On any given day, the backups are 5 to 6 miles. It's a 5-mile backup, which means that if you take 20% their maximum, you're left with a 4-mile backup. You will not be able to get, and who in here sitting in a 4-mile backup is going to let someone merge into that general purpose lane from a toll lane to get off in the next? None of us. Let's be real about that. So when we talk about it's going to relieve congestion, It relieves congestion, but it doesn't come close to making it manageable for people that have to use this road because they have nowhere else to go.
This is a big concern. Operator's goal is to maximize profit. Community's goal is to maximize throughput, minimize congestion, and enhance economic development. If this were being ran by NCDOT, at least we'd have the same agenda. So this is the slide, and this is when the engineering comes in. Okay? As an engineer, I looked at this. This is a slide, and I've actually, Bobby and Roger have seen this, and they say, well, it's changed. I'm okay if it's changed. But it could be an order of magnitude off, and it's still bad. This is if we do nothing. And again, the guys that make it clear, I-77 HOV hot lane conversion traffic operations technical memorandum, Atkins, July 2012. This is an NCDOT Federal Highways slide. No build, one hot lane, above two people can use it for free. One hot lane, three can use it for three. Two hot lanes, two people can use it for three. Two hot lanes, three plus people can use it for free. This is what we're building. The average speed, if we do nothing, according to this DOT chart, is 27.1. Once we're done, the average speed in the general purpose lanes will be 26.8. So no matter what we're told, we do not buy, it will relieve congestion. Next slide. Worst of all, it shows here, again, same thing. This is a Stantec, which is the federal government. Langtree to Catawba, which, for those of you from CRTPO, basically is Cornelius across the lake up into Mooresville. It shows here in 2015, and we build this day, it will take 7 and 8% of the traffic. Their numbers, not ours. Next slide. In 2035, 20 years from now, they're telling us it'll take 13 to 15% traffic. Okay? You can begin to see why we as a community. It's not about politics. It's not about road theory. It's about the reality of there has not been roads built in North Mecklenburg, and the solution we have is not going to maximize the throughput. And this community, because we have not built roads in 20 years, needs a solution that will maximize throughput. And we know we got to start another bypass lane on the other side. So let's make that the toll lane. But we need to maximize throughput because those are our only options today. Next slide. Just goes back then. This is the last thing, the thing that probably bothers us really from a goal standpoint. This was one of the original goals. The goal was to guarantee travel times from Charlotte to North Mecklenburg. That's really not what we need. Our problem is, yeah, we love travel times, but it's more important that we drive, the Lake Norman community is a working community of its own. Those of you who live here know that we have northbound traffic and southbound traffic in the mornings. There's people coming up. It is not a rush hour. We're going to Charlotte for the work. Most of the people live and work up here. There's still a large number, or some people go to Charlotte, but frankly, there's a lot of people from Charlotte that come to Lowe's, that come to Ingersoll Rand, to come to MSC, and come to the other 4,000 businesses that exist in North Mecklenburg and South Iredell. What's missing, obviously, congestion relief. Next slide. I think we've hit that enough. This is another thing that just came up. The toll lanes are only going to be built at 17 inches. Truck traffic requires 34 inches. Boy, if this master plan doesn't work, we feel we're losing our flexibility. We feel this is a bad way if it doesn't work and they have to redo it. Not only do we have to, they alluded, Secretary Tennyson and Grace said, well, we can change it. We can change it if we pay a very, very large financial penalty. Everybody wants to talk about the penalty today. We believe, the business community and the community believe, the penalty today will be an order of magnitude smaller than the penalty we'll have to pay in our future. And the last thing we'll address is economic development. Jim, I'll let you hit this.
Basically, we have a couple of things here. We talked about the input from the state $95 million. That's just completely wrong. It's not $95 million. Because the bonus allocation of $145, $77 million of that builds two interchanges. Okay, so the, when we talk about $100 million to get out of this, we save $77 million the first day. There's $75 million of backstop money. If anyone here is familiar with the Whitewater Center, when we built the Whitewater Center, I was there, we voted on that. The whole idea was it probably won't make money in the very beginning, so we will give them $1 million a year to keep them afloat. There's $75 million of that in this plan. It would cost about $250 million just to build the general purpose lanes. That's what we've asked with CODT. We don't hold them to that. They've actually said less, but we think it's about that. We talk about the default. I've got the contract right here. And in one section, it talks about default. And the remedy for the default goes back to the developer. So we can chat about that, but I've got the contract here. And again, we go back to the very first debt is paid in 2 weeks. A child born today will be 18 years old, graduating high school before the first dollar of debt is paid. So if they default, guess who's on the hook for that default money? If they go bankrupt, it's a different animal. If they default, we are, because they haven't been paying down that debt. Next. There was no economic impact study done for this road. NCDOT doesn't do economic impact studies. They did one on I-95, but they didn't do one on I-77. It's fine. Their job is to build roads. Our job and the chamber's job is to protect business. There was no economic impact study done to say, what will this plan do? It takes some congestion, no talk about the impact. $12.5 billion over the next 50 years leaves this community. That's the tolls. Say what you will about it. That's their estimates. $12.5 billion comes out of the pockets of the citizens here, some people riding through town, and goes to investors, etc. That's why we don't have a problem. The state of North Carolina ran it, and the $12.5 billion, at least it would go to the state of North Carolina. You have productivity loss over congestion. We've got slides that will show projections from a doctor of transportation of the lost productivity because of congestion. Next. The biggest thing here is truck commerce. Truck commerce on interstates is growing at if I remember correctly, 4 to 5 times faster than automobiles. Okay. And that was done before eBay and Amazon became the new mall. You now have the stuff brought to you. Truck traffic will increase. Yes, we can pay the penalty to widen the road, but the trucks can't use that toll lane. We'd have to tear it out. And what most people here don't understand is you got to get across the water. So if you want to expand it, we have given up our right-of-way. The state of North Carolina, the citizens of North Carolina own dry land going across Lake Norman today. We are giving that to another company for 50 years, which means that not if, when we have to expand this, particularly for truck traffic, we're building over water. We, the citizens, the state of North Carolina, take the risk of will that comply with environmental protection at that time. You know, we say we aren't going to do politics. Let's say Bernie Sanders becomes the president of the United States and says you can't build roads over any body of water. You can't remove a snail darter. You can't, whatever it might, we don't know what the restrictions will be 15 years down the road. We've given up the dry land to a private company. We then have to deal with how we meet those expectations, and we throttle our truck traffic. Those of you who've been here long enough to know what I'm talking about when I say the Yadkin River Bridge, they widened 85 on both sides of it. But when you got to the Yadkin River, it was two lanes across. This is the exact same thing. We are man-making our own Yadkin River Bridge in the future, and then we're going to figure out how to deal with it because we gave away our only solution.
That, by the way, are a bunch of NASCAR haulers
They also realize this is a problem because they get trucks in and out of here all the time. It's a multi-billion dollar industry. Right here is epicenter of it. Why do you think they were the first businesses to say this is a bad idea? Because they're the ones putting trucks on that road every single week.
And for you guys from the CRTPO, we understand your challenge. We understand what we're dealing with, where we are, Lake Norman, despite what we heard because of this issue. Sure, we're passionate. Sure, we're scared to death about our community. Okay? I was talking to Speaker Tillis last week, and for the first time I said, you know, for the first time in my life, I could imagine not being buried at Lake Norman. And I never thought that would be the case. But we're regional players. Okay? But the truck traffic is, I-77 is one of two north-south roads through the state of North Carolina. We need to take care of that. We need to do what's necessary, not for Lake Norman, but for the state of North Carolina and the commerce of the state of North Carolina. Then we look at this. If you were a business, you know what you know now, where would you move? Where would you move?
I-85 in Cabarrus County has been widened, no tolls. I-85 in Gaston County, it's been widened, no tolls. I-77 south in York County, widened, no tolls. If I gotta get trucks and transportation on there, why do I go there? Why is it that we are the only MPO that said tolls? All our adjacent neighbors said no. Where would you build a business? I'm in the manufacturing services business. I tell you, they don't build it where they have a problem getting in and out quick.
Go ahead. Hurry up, John.
We're wrapping up. I can honestly say
that this community is against this plan. What we had in 2010 is not what we have today. And we are taking a firm stance that we asked you to cancel this contract. We don't want to blow up the STI. We have confidence the new STI will work better for us. If you score it from 20 to 36, we think we'll be fine. But it will give us a solution. Will it set us back? We know it'll set us back. But it will give us a solution because we do not feel that this is a solution. If it's done in 3 years, it still is not a solution for our congestion. And we don't believe that is. Cancel the contract, put it under the P4, and let's put the project scope where it should be. Jim?
That's it. We've taken a little over 30 minutes, although we have a whole lot to tell you that isn't out there on web pages. Before we're gone, we'll have some closing remarks, so I'll kind of do that. But what happens is this is a geographic problem. It's not a theory problem. P3s work in a lot of places. Managed lanes work in a whole lot of places. They don't work where you've got a body of water and no infrastructure to serve the community. When you've got to exit Main Street every 2 miles, there aren't other interstates out there where you go every 2 miles, you get off, and there's 70,000 people living within 2 miles of that. So I can't wait to hear the questions. We've got plenty more to say, more specifics, but thank you for your patience.
I'd like to thank both the DOT and the Lake Norman Chamber folks for their presentations today. Let me tell you the process here moving forward. We're going to take a quick break for those of you all who had a lot of coffee this morning, about 10 or 15 minutes. Why don't we say 10:35. Let's try to be back here. That gives everybody 10 minutes. We will then do Q&A from the participants. Each side will get closing comments. And we'll go from there. Thank you all so much. Be back in 10 minutes.